I've only ever read Iain Banks' science fiction novels, which of course means I've never read an Iain Banks at all. Iain Banks was a writer of non-genre books, whereas Iain M. Banks only wrote science fiction. Both were Scottish, both died too young, leaving the world bereft of a body of work we might otherwise have enjoyed. We will never know what Iain Banks could have done if he'd worked within science fiction, and we are robbed of the acclaimed science fiction author Iain M. Banks' potential output outside the genre. Luckily, Iain M. Banks wrote enough science fiction for both of them with his famous Culture series. The world depicted in the Culture series is so far beyond ours in terms of scope and scale, as well as just linear time. But despite how different his setting is from just real life, he's an author that I always associate with real life in a capital R, capital L sense. I'll explain what I mean. Eventually, when things were starting to pick up, but we still didn't quite know where to put ourselves yet, we went to France on a ferry. To get to the ferry, we took the train, and while we waited for the train, I browsed the bookshop at the station. They had The Player of Games, another Iain M. Banks, and I bought it for the holiday, not realising it was the second book in the series. We had our little holiday, and we came home, and things were much better than they had been, but I still hadn't sold any of my work yet. I still wasn't doing the things that I was supposed to be doing. Real life was happening, and it was threatening to ruin everything. I didn't know it at the time, but I was about to sell my first artwork, and things were about to start getting better. Before long, I was working on a magazine and still working my way through The Player of Games. But until then, I used to go on walks, having learned that I was actually quite good at reading while walking, and The Player of Games just really excited me. I loved it. This was the moment when I clicked with Iain M. Banks. I loved how he described so complexly a game that was so complicated and science fiction and incomprehensible, without ever once actually telling you what it is. The characters were interesting, the settings were fascinating. And there was a little seat that I found on the route I used to walk, and I would just sit there and read. I had to stop eventually, because the seat wasn't actually a comfortable one. In fact, it was positively unpleasant. I mean, I've heard of worse. But first, before I get into a proper ramble, let's talk about use of weapons. This is a really, really interesting book. Everything about the way use of weapons is laid out is fascinating, even before you really get a handle on what's going on. Straight away, we get to find out about a character called Zakalwe. Now, I thought, as I was reading the book, that he was the focus of all of the first chapters. But I later discovered, looking back, that this was part of the illusion created by the book's really interesting structure, which I'll tell you about in a minute. In fact, Zakalwe only even appears in half of those chapters, and in the other lot, the main character is Dizzy at Smart, who is searching for Zakalwe but can't seem to get in touch with him. His absence is the focus of those chapters. He isn't there at all in those chapters, but because of their positioning in the book, because of the unusual order in which the story is delivered, I was fooled into feeling like he was there throughout. By the way, yes, I'm going with Zakalwe and Dizzy at Smart. This is a culture book, and so the names are, I suspect, deliberately calculated to be unpronounceable. So if you've got a better idea, or if you've got a clip of the author actually saying the names out loud, then I'd be interested to hear that. So it took me a long time to read Consider Phlebas, and real life prevented me from ever really getting into it. It could be a great book, it could be a terrible book, I can't tell you. For me, it's the background music to a zombie walk. It's a paragraph here and a sentence and a half there that I could glance at to distract me from the unpleasant sandwich filling that I'd picked out this week, and the soggy tin foil that the sandwiches had got crushed in on the way. I confess I was bored with it. I didn't understand it. To me, it seemed like a series of random, unconnected things happening, and I couldn't figure out what story or ideas connected them all together. I read it so gradually, and in such small chunks. I'm not kidding, sometimes it would be a sentence and a half, and that was all I read that day, and so I never gave myself the chance to really figure out what it was all about. I basically just lost track of it. I didn't have time for stories anymore. One of my bosses called me into her office one day and asked me to pull up a chair. It was one of those situations where you know all about what's happened, but you don't think there's going to be a chance to explain. She said, "You can't even look me in the eye," and told me that I would be fired if I wasn't going to be leaving soon anyway. I won't bore you with it. It wasn't even a serious accusation like stealing or being rude to a customer or anything like that. And it wasn't even true anyway. A shopper came up to me afterwards who'd seen it all, and she said she was disgusted with the way I'd been treated. And I think she was trying to encourage me to stand up for myself, but at that point I didn't have the strength anymore. Consider Phlebas, in other words, didn't get my full attention. I didn't give it its fair shot, but I do always associate it with real life. Anyway, that was a tangent. Back to Zakalwe. When we first hear about Zakalwe, it's as a guy who can just get stuff done, without really any more information than that. We don't know exactly what stuff, and we don't know what his job will be. He's just someone that the culture know they can hire. And if they do, there'll be a certain amount of mayhem, and it won't go exactly according to plan, but the actual thing they wanted doing will get done, because he is very gifted in the use of weapons. More on that in a moment. Meanwhile, in the chapters where we actually meet Zakalwe, he's doing anything from assassinating kings to being temporarily beheaded. And there doesn't at first seem to be much linking the episodes together, so are we being shown just random snippets from this guy's history? Or is it all adding up to something? There may be young people just entering their 20s who can wake up at 5 a.m. every morning for months without feeling any adverse effects. I was not one of those people. Every day I would eat my packed lunch during my 20-minute mid-morning break, which was a trick I'd learned at school when I was about 12. If you finish off your lunch during the shorter mid-morning break, then that gives you the entire lunch break, which is usually longer, for just doing whatever you want. Well, if you've ever been sleep-deprived for a number of weeks, you will know that there is a point at which you just stop caring about what people around you think anymore. Or rather, you just stop being aware of them. You will happily just lean against something and just shut down until someone stops you. It's not that you want to, there just isn't an option, it's just what your body does. This job didn't really provide anywhere for us to be during our lunch break. I mean, legally they did, there was the legally required lunch room, but that consisted of this one desolate chair. It was meant to be more, but the rest of the initial five or so had usually been pilfered for some reason or another each day. That chair was the source of much unhappiness for all involved, because it was right in the way of anyone who needed to bring a cage of goods out from the storeroom to the shop floor, which it was basically everyone's job to do all day, all the time. So you couldn't actually really stay there. You certainly couldn't fall asleep there. So instead we were all forced to our feet, plodding the polished halls of the shopping centre and trying to find somewhere to stop. The benches were always full, the food court was always full, and I was confronted for the first time with the depressing correlation between having work that's supposed to keep you comfortable and having nowhere to go and no options. We were down to 30 quid in the bank, hundreds to go out on rent and bills and things, and not even, in our case, any of the usual adult vices like smoking or drinking to blame for the gap in our funds. It just wasn't enough. The only option that presented itself regularly enough was a coffee shop with no front wall and tables reaching all the way up to the entrance. I can't remember why, but it was the table in the entrance that I would always sit down at every day, and every day I'd get out, consider Phlebas, and I'd open it up to wherever I'd got to, and every day when my watch alarm rang to tell me it was time to go back to the shop, it woke me up. I don't know why they didn't ban me from the shop. Every day I would sit there and within minutes I was just asleep, spread out across the tabletop. But I'm glad they didn't, because there was just no alternative. Gradually we come to learn that Zakalwe is, as I said, someone who is very gifted in the use of weapons. And the book gives us a number of different definitions of this. A weapon doesn't just have to be a gun. It can be a person, or it can be information. It can even be something really mundane, but presented and used in the most devastating context. The book shows us lots of different times when weapons of all different kinds are used. And it asks us whether it's ever justified, and which ones are worse. If the aim is precise, is one trigger objectively more dangerous than another when pulled, or is it all the same? There's one line which I didn't notice at the time as being interesting, but when I found it again while I was flicking through the book to look stuff up for this video, I actually made the sound, ha! The line is a gamble, and on a lot of readers it won't work, but I'm apparently just stupid enough that it did work. The first time I read it one way, and now that I've read the rest of the book, it means something completely else entirely. I love that sort of thing, and it turns out that the more I think about it, or flick through it, or read about it in people's discussions online, this entire book is made of that sort of thing. I haven't done this yet, but it's very clear that the second time you read the book, the whole book will be worth more than it was the first time, during which you were being knowingly confused and sometimes deceived. For the curious, the line I'm talking about, and this is a spoiler, so get ready with your mute button and I'm going to tell you when to mute it, and then when I've finished saying the spoiler, I'll go. The line I'm talking about, okay, mute the sound now if you haven't read the book, is the last line of chapter 1. That's Roman numeral 1, so the final sentence before the last chapter, chapter 14, with an F. However, I found another one in chapter Roman numeral 8, which is VIII. There's a paragraph towards the end of that chapter, which begins, "He tried to tell himself that mostly he'd won." Have a look at what the last sentence in that paragraph says. In fact, there's other stuff I found in that chapter while looking for what paragraph that line was in, so I can tell you here, including the "Do you know my name or rank?" exchange just a couple of paragraphs earlier. Suddenly, all of this stuff is really interesting, and that's just bits that I fell on when I opened the book to look for quotes and to look up things. It's all over the place. So this book is way cleverer than I thought. That second read-through, when it happens, that's going to be the real read-through. It was absolutely bucketing down with rain by the time I got to the Trafford Centre. It was the tail end of the year, and so everything was starting to crisp up, not least the shirt of my new uniform, which was never completely quite dry after being in the wash overnight, and which caught the worst of the frost each day as I stood waiting for the bus and the daylight to show up. There were seats at the bus stop, but they were these little plastic rectangles that seemed designed to be perpetually tipping you off, rather than letting you actually rest. Honestly, that seat would cause more pain than anything else. Anyway, that bus stop wasn't even where my bus stopped, so I had to choose how long to risk sitting there, whether I'd have enough time to run to where my bus actually stopped, which was just a pole with a sign on it further up the road. Eventually I found a shop that sold a fold-up chair that you could carry with you, and I was thinking I could set that up at the bus stop, and I nearly bought it, but all I could think about was how it would be this burden that I would have to deal with, when the way to the bus stop was already a distance I had to sprint just to get to each morning. By the time I got there, my lungs were hurting and there was nowhere to sit. Anyway, that first day as I stepped off the bus, I couldn't even see where I was going. The rain was so thick, couldn't even find the entrance. The Trafford Centre is this big domed palace of shopping in Manchester, and usually it's crammed full of people. But that day, because it was so early in the morning, it was empty, and I was entering via a trade entrance to start my new job. It wasn't my first job, but it was the first one that I had to commit to for what felt back then like a long time. I was going to be stacking shelves, hauling boxes, and doing generally difficult to enjoy things all day for quite a while. And that's the sort of thing that a kid straight out of school can get a bit downhearted about. And of course I did, but not at the start. At the start I could escape, because whatever happened, I had a galaxy in my hand. Banks is a writer who doesn't often tell you what to do with the information he's giving you, which can make that information seem sort of arbitrary and random if you're not clever enough to thread it all together. And I'm really not clever enough. I mean, I never even figured out what Consider Phlebas was about. But I'll tell you about that in a minute. But in this book, even if it took me to the end of the book to really cotton on, the information that you're being given adds up to a study of two characters. No, it's cleverer than that. It's a study of the reader's response to two characters. It shows you two characters, it gives you some glimpses into their lives, and then it asks you what you think drives them. It pushes you into a position of approving of one and being dead against the other. And then it makes you admit that a horrible person and a decent person could have traits in common with one another, even if their most memorable deeds, good or bad, are what ultimately define them. It gives you an out, because the book ends rather abruptly, you don't have to think about it again. But if you do, if you look back over the book and think about what really motivated these characters, given all the information you now have, suddenly you're re-evaluating not just scenes from this book through the lens of the information you're now armed with, but also your understanding of bigger issues that apply outside the story. Good guys versus bad guys. People who are on opposing sides on whatever scale, from war to just personal vendettas. You think about how you're capable, sometimes unconsciously, but sometimes deliberately, of putting people in a villain box or in a hero box, based on scraps of information about their lives, which, of course, from your limited perspective, is all you can ever have. Well, what if you'd seen different scraps? What if the people who support bad ideas or side with bad people just saw different scraps than you? And here's a big one. If someone does something, one thing, that is unforgivable, does that define who they are forever? Does it change who they were before they did it? And does it affect who they can ever possibly come to be again? If the rest of the perpetrator's life comes to be defined by what they did and their attempts to atone for it, can they still never be forgiven? What if their one terrible act was exactly, precisely, the worst possible thing that a person could do? Either things were about to start happening, or it was all about to fall apart. We jumped into renting a flat we couldn't afford on the basis that we were too young to know how being grown-ups actually worked, so we might as well just do it and see what happened. What happened, of course, would depend on whether or not we could make any money, so I'd been doing some little jobs here and there to see if I could bring any in while my girlfriend finished her last year at university. I was walking into town just to wander about, just to be free and explore, because I was celebrating one of my last days without a job. In a few days' time, I'd be stacking big shelves at a big shop in a big shopping centre. And that meant that there was now a feeling of stability. Free time was now something that could be enjoyed rather than a source of panic. So I found myself at the bookshop, browsing the science fiction section, and I realised today was the day to finally try out Iain M. Banks. I'd heard he was worth getting into, and this week, of all weeks, I could finally afford to actually try it. So I picked up the first book, Consider Phlebas, and then I found myself a chair, and I sat down and read. Before I knew it, I couldn't stop reading. I was walking through town with my nose in this book, discovering that it was possible to actually walk and read at the same time, using peripheral vision to avoid crashing into people. And I kept reading all the way through a haircut. It was like this. And the barber was going, you like this book, don't you? And I'm like, yeah, I think I do. And I kept reading all the way home, just walking and reading, getting quite good at avoiding all the lampposts and things, walking and reading. So when I finally set off for the first day of the new job, despite the fact that it was starting to rain, it was with Consider Phlebas in my hand. Not in my bag, in my hand. So I've already alluded to it, but I would be remiss if I didn't tell you about this book's unusual timeline, which is perhaps its most memorable feature. From the outset, it appears to feature two separate stories, with the book's chapters alternating between the two. But there's something weirder than that going on, because the chapters of one of the stories are running in reverse order, backwards in time. And both of the stories are about Sherrad and Iain Zakalwy. And it very quickly becomes clear that this allows the author to present some piece of information in one chapter, and then another piece of information in the chapter adjacent to it, I hesitate to say the next chapter, in ways that are carefully calculated so that the details kind of play off one another and inform you about what's going on in a non-linear way, forcing you into a non-linear understanding of the story, or rather of its characters. In other words, if you'd read the Zakalwy story in order, it would just tell you a story. But instead, having a cloud of information about who the man is descend on you from all directions and sort of settle on your brain like a surrounding mist, that gives you the chance to understand him in your own way before you're given the terms of the story. Before the story, you know, tells you what you should be thinking. So you make up your own mind, and then, as you start to find out where all of this came from, as you become informed in the way that you ordinarily would have been from the outset in a normal book, you start to realise things about how you form impressions of people and form opinions of people. And, well, as you may have been able to tell, I might not be as clever as Iain M. Banks. I think that might be my point. By the way, in case you don't know, I was kidding before. Iain Banks and Iain M. Banks are not different writers. I hope nobody took what I said at face value. What happened in 2013 would have been a rather sinister coincidence, if so. I was coming home from the hospital one day that summer. And as I say, all my Iain M. Banks memories are sort of connected in various ways to real life stuff. And real life does bring up things like hospitals and illness from time to time, even for those of us who are lucky enough to be relatively healthy. Not everyone, however, is so lucky. And as I wandered into a bookshop on the way back to shamefully thumb through paperbacks I already had on order for cheaper from Amazon, unaware that about a year later the bookshop would be closed, thanks at least in part to people like me, I spotted a table inside the entrance with a photograph of a silvery beardy face and the words In Memoriam and a dwindling pyramid of culture novels. Ugh, that's cold. I'm just gonna go and heat this up, hold on. Banks, both of him, had announced his diagnosis in April, and by June had died. See? Real life stuff. I imagine it was probably around then that I decided it was about time I revisited the culture. I'd been there before, twice. The first time in particular is a memory that I'll always associate with real life, grown up, not really, frankly, very pleasant times. Hello, I'm Dave. Welcome back to the Book Corner. Today, I'm going to be talking about Use of Weapons by Iain M. Banks.